So silk is a natural protein filament spun by silkworm for its cocoon, and its density is 1.3 grams per cubic centimeter. And here it's about the moth, and just introduction part is covered in this slide. How the cocoon is forming a continuous filament, and we have defined here the two parts of this. A single row silk filament comprised of finer filaments called the fibroin, which are triangular in shape, and each fibroin filament is surrounded by a gummy substance. This thing is repeating again and again throughout the topic because it is very important to understand this. So here we have indicated this silk filament, the whole silk filament, the one unit which is having two brins and cementing material, or overall is known as, overall this structure is known as bave. Some silk producing countries, name of silk producing countries are covered in this. Production of silk, we have divided into two parts, sericulture and reeling of raw silk. So first stage is sericulture, that is divided into four different stages of life cycle: egg, larva, cocoon, and adult moth. So here we have taken this egg, caterpillar, chrysalis, which is also known as cocoon, or which is also known as pupa, and moth stage. So we have divided the whole life cycle of silk into silkworm into four stages, different stages of life of this. And they are having interesting functions during the different parts or different stages of life cycle that we have taken in detail on this slide. So I don't think there is a need to repeat it again. So from what is happening or what the functions it is performing during egg stage, caterpillar stage, chrysalis or pupa stage, and then moth stage. Yeah, one more important thing in this is we terminate the life cycle of silk here when we want to produce a continuous silk filament. And when we want to grow the silkworm into moth, in breeder moths particularly, to lay eggs and again to get cocoon, for that purpose, we are not terminating life here. Most of the time we are terminating the life here so that we can get a continuous silk filament. But sometimes we are allowing to grow into breeder moths, of good quality of breeder moths, and then they are laying eggs and again silkworm, and then again the same stages are followed and we are getting continuous silk filament. Here we have explained the formation of cocoon separately, how it is the cocoon is formed during the life cycle of silkworm. Then we have taken production of raw silk and divided them into four stages: drawing, shorting, cooking, brushing, and rilling. Rilling is the main part. First four are the preparatory processes for rilling, and that we have taken into detail. And with the help of diagram, we have taken this, and we are winding this silk filament, which we are taking from this cocoon and winding it onto this, and this package is known as skeins, S-K-E-I-N-S, skeins. Then these are packed into six ponds of books of six ponds, and then packed into bales form for shipment. So after reeling, we are getting a silk filament, but it is not, it cannot be used for next processes or subsequent processes like weaving and other processes. And for that reason, to provide extra strength or to provide this additional strength to the silk filaments so that it can withstand the forces of weaving, particularly for warp yarn, we are twisting them. We are imparting twist. So we are doubling number of silk filaments together according to the doubling and how much twist we are giving. They are named accordingly. So this process is known as throwing processes. And that is also having different stages of shorting, shocking, drying, winding, doubling, and then finally twisting. And then it is conditioned. After that, after this conditioning, we are getting a thrown silk yarn. This yarn will be known as thrown silk yarn. Before that, it is reeled silk or raw silk yarn. The raw silk filament after the process of throwing is known as thrown silk yarn, which is having number of stages, which we have covered already. The next process is degumming, in which we are mainly removing the sarrasin, and due to removal of sarrasin, approximately 20 to 25% weight of the material may be lost, and it will affect the costing. So the cost will get increased. But for higher good qualities, the customer can bear the cost. So we are using the degummed silk. But sometimes to overcome the cost, we are going through a weighing process in which it absorbs certain salts and gain the weight. So cost will be reduced. Yeah, after this, we have covered varieties of thrown silk yarn. And I have mentioned the number of reeled thread twisted together and amount of twist per unit length. These two are the deciding factors, or these two, all this thrown silk yarn, different varieties of thrown silk yarn are differing with respect to these two points. And that we have taken by some examples like singles, trams, organzine, crap, grenkeline, pumpenzine, sewing silk. All these are the different varieties of silk filament yarn. And then we have another quality of silk yarn that is known as spun silk, which is formed from short lengths of inferior silk filaments. Previous, whatever the varieties we have covered, they are a continuous silk filament. But now spun silk is not a continuous silk filament. It is spun from smaller fiber, short length silk filaments, which are broken due to many reasons that we have covered here, like PS cocoons, double cocoons, the flaws, the frisson, and the scrape. All these waste materials are used and converted into silk yarn with the help of spinning process. And that silk is known as spun silk yarn. And silk noil is again the waste we are getting from spun silk. During the process of spun silk, that waste is also used and converted into yarn, and that is known as silk noil. However, it is a very coarse and rough quality of silk, but still it is used for some inferior qualities of silk materials. So these were the varieties of silk yarn. We have two topics in silks: varieties of silk yarn and varieties of silk. Both are different. So try to clear the difference between these two. Then yesterday we have taken fiber morphology of silk, the macrostructure, in which we have covered how the fiber looks, what is the dimensions like length, diameter, length L by D ratio, and about the luster. Then in microscopic view, we have taken three types of silk. One is mulberry silk, their longitudinal and cross-sectional view. Then degummed silk, their longitudinal and cross-sectional view. And then wild silk, in which we have taken tussar silk, longitudinal and cross-sectional view. And what is the effect of this characteristic microscopic appearance? Why we are getting this particular characteristic microscopic appearance is given here due to slit-like opening. And then we have taken the microstructure of silk, which is not having no identifiable, which has no identifiable microstructure like cotton and wool. Then silk polymer. In silk polymer, we have taken that it is a linear fibroin polymer and having 16 different amino acids, in which 80% part consists of mainly three amino acids, alanine, glycine, and serine. Another thing which we have covered in this silk polymer, the important thing is it is not containing any amino acid which is having sulfur groups. And if sulfur is absent, then disulfide bonds are absent in case of silk, which are found in wool fiber. And the silk polymer occurs only in the beta configuration. There was a question from a student about beta configuration that we will take in the next slide. Yes, the beta configuration means this folded configuration, which is shown here. If the polymers are arranged in a folded configuration like this, not in helical configuration, it is a folded configuration. And this folded configuration is known as beta configuration, which is main characteristic of polymer system of silk fiber. So, and it is a highly crystalline fiber having 65 to 75% crystalline regions and 35 to 25% amorphous regions. And main types of bonds which are prevailing in silk filament or silk fiber is hydrogen bonds and ionic bonds, also known as salt linkages. And due to this beta configuration, a very close packing of polymers is possible. And due to very close packing, it is highly crystalline fiber having 65 to 75% crystalline regions. Then we have taken chemical composition. In chemical composition, first we have taken chemical composition of silk, which is mainly containing fibrin and sericin, and a little percentage of other things like waxy matter, carbohydrates, mineral matters, and coloring matters. And then we have taken chemical composition of fibrin and sericin, which is containing carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, and oxygen in different proportions. The last topic which we have covered in the previous class is variety of silk. And we have categorized them into mainly two varieties, domesticated, or also known as mulberry, and wild silk, which are also known as non-mulberry. So we have divided the whole industry of silk into two categories, mulberry silk and non-mulberry silk. Means this, if the silkworm is fed on this mulberry leaves or the leaves of mulberry trees, and it is domesticated in the particular sericulture through some sericulture process in magnanaries, it is known as domesticated silk. But if it is not taken care by the man and it is growing itself and producing cocoon, that type of silk is known as wild silk. So because the domesticated silk, in case of domesticated silk, the silk worm is fed on mulberry leaves or mulberry trees. So that particular type of silk is known as mulberry silk, and others are known as non-mulberry silks. In non-mulberry silk or wild silk, there are three main varieties: tussar, airy, and muga. So we have taken here something details about mulberry silk, airy silk, tussar silk, and muga silk. So in all these four topics, all these four types, basic difference is on which plant they are we are feeding them, and what type of quality it is going to produce, and the areas where it is produced in India. That is covered in these slides. And then we have taken major differences between domesticated and wild silk with the help of this table. So at the left side, we are taking domesticated silk. Right hand side, we are taking wild silk. And we are comparing them on the basis of their value, means cost. Another is their specie, like silkworm of domesticated is Bombyx mori. For tussar, there are three different: tussar, muga, and airy, Antheria milita, Antheria asama, Attacus resin, respectively. These are fed on mulberry leaves. They are fed on different plants. It is under controlled condition. That is not on controlled condition. Usually, giving more stronger and more alkali resistant silk. Here we are getting a continuous filament. In the case of wild silk, we are getting short lengths because the life cycle is not terminated at the stage of pupa in case of wild silk. Less impurities, here the higher impurities because it is wild. We are not taking care of anything here. Here we are getting finer filaments, here coarser filaments. This domesticated silk is more lustrous. It is less lustrous, less resistance to moisture. This is highly resistant to moisture and other chemicals also. And it is more expensive, that we have already covered in the first point, commercially valuable, less valuable. So first and 10th point are almost similar. So far we have taken, or we have covered these topics from silk. So this, the purpose of revision was that the students who have missed the classes also can know about the contents so that they can cover the contents. And if you have any problem in these contents, you feel free to ask me on WhatsApp, either in the group. It will be better if you can ask me on personal box. Yes. The next topic which we are going to cover today is physical properties. And as I mentioned, we are taking both the fibers together, wool and silk. So then it will be better, it will be easy to remember also, because we are comparing these two fibers, which are from the category of natural polyamide fibers. So tenacity, the first characteristic we are taking is tenacity. Wool is considered as a weak fiber, whereas silk is considered as a strong fiber. It's a dry tenacity of wool and wet tenacity. So dry tenacity of wool is, it's a mistake, 9 to 8 grams per tex. No, I have to check it. I think it is 9 to 18 grams per tex. And wet tenacity is 7 to 16 grams per tex. Whereas silk is having high tenacity. Dry tenacity is 30 to 41, whereas wet tenacity is 23 to 32. In both the cases, wet tenacity is lesser than dry tenacity. Cotton is the only fiber which is gaining strength when it is wet. Other fibers are losing strength when they are in wet condition. And particularly viscose fiber loses a very significant amount when it is in wet condition. So cotton is the only fiber which is gaining strength when it is wet. And here is the wet dry ratio, 78 to 89%, here 77 to 78%. The low tensile strength of wool is due to the relatively few hydrogen bonds that are formed. When wet, the water molecules gradually force sufficient polymers apart to cause significant number of hydrogen bonds to break. And in addition, the water molecules hydrolyze many salt linkages in amorphous regions of the wool fiber, results in a loss in tenacity. So here, the reason is given why the wool fiber is considered as weak fiber or having low tenacity as compared to silk. The reason is it is having low tensile strength due to relatively few hydrogen bonds. Number of hydrogen bonds formed in wool are very less due to its bulkier nature, because the fiber and the polymers are more bulky, having side chains, and due to that, closer packing is not possible. And if closer packing is not possible, then the gap interpolymer spaces between the polymers will be more. And even interpolymer forces of interpolymer spaces are more, it means hydrogen bonds formation will be less. So due to less number of hydrogen bonds formed, it is having low strength. And why it is losing strength when it is wet? Because water molecules gradually enters into this polymer system and gradually force the sufficient polymers apart. Polymers ke beech mein, jab water molecules enter karenge, to polymers ke beech mein space bad jayega. Agar space badhta hai, to jo hydrogen bonds pehle form huye hain, wo bhi break ho jayenge. Yani ki number of hydrogen bonds will get decreased. Kam ho jayenge. Hydrogen bonds aur kam hone se wet strength aur kam ho raha hai. And in addition to this, the water molecules hydrolyze many salt linkages. So ionic bonds hai, unko bhi hydrolyze kar dete hain, particularly in amorphous regions only. And then it results in a loss of tenacity. Whereas the explanation for the strength of silk is given here. This strength is due to linear beta configuration polymers, because it is a folded configuration. So closer packing is possible. Closer packing means the interpolymer spaces will be less. Interpolymer spaces is less means interpolymer forces of attraction will be more. And interpolymer forces of is more, it means strength will be more. And very crystalline polymer system. Due to this beta configuration, a high number of bonds are formed, high number of hydrogen bonds are formed due to closer packing of polymers. And due to closer packing of polymers, crystalline regions are increased. And due to these two reasons, it permits more hydrogen bonds to be formed in a much regular manner. When wet, silk loses strength. This is due to water molecules hydrolyzing a significant number of hydrogen bonds, results in the loss in tenacity. This reason is similar for woolen silk, but it is having high strength. So reasons are different. Here it is having less strength. So reasons are explained here. So this is all about the tenacity of wool and silk. Then another property we are covering is elastic plastic nature, means elasticity property. So here you can compare these two, elongation. When elongation is 2%, elastic recovery is 99%. When stretch or elongation is 5%, 98%. And when it is 10%, it is 90%. So these data are indicating that, clearly indicating that we will have a very good elastic recovery and excellent resilience. You can see here, even at 5% stretch or elongation, it is gaining 98%. So wool is considered as an excellent elastic fiber. We have 10 minutes more. The reasons are given here. This is due to its crimped configuration and partly to the alpha keratin configuration of wool polymers. Reason of high elasticity property of wool is given here because wool is having crimped configuration. So this crimped configuration allows more elastic property, and partly to the alpha keratin configuration. Alpha keratin means helical configuration, and helical configuration allows more elastic properties because when we stretch it, it gains again its original position. So when stretched or compressed, the wool polymers will always tend to return to their alpha keratin or coiled configuration. जैसे हम उसको कर या stretch करेंगे, again वो वापस अपनी alpha keratin position, helical position में या coiled configuration में आने की कोशिश करेगा, so that it will give good elastic property. This ability is due to interpolymer cystine linkages and hydrogen bonds. Repeated stretching may permanently deform wool fibers. But as हम इसको repeatedly stretch करेंगे बार बार, and उसके अंदर उसके अगर repeated stretching अगर हो रहा है तो deformation हो जाएगा. जैसा कि हम देखते हैं, हम जब woolen cloths को hang करते हैं अगर wires के ऊपर सुखाने के लिए, तो धीरे धीरे उसकी elastic property कम हो जाती है. तभी हम उनको जनरली किसी बेड शीट के ऊपर डाल करके बिना हैंग किए हम सुखाएंगे तो उसकी इलास्टिक प्रॉपर्टी मेंटेन रहेगी. हियर मोर प्लास्टिक देन इलास्टिक सिल्क इज नॉट हैविंग गुड इलास्टिक प्रॉपर्टीज. यू कैन सी इवन एट 2% स्ट्रेच और इलोंगेशन इट इज गेनिंग 92% ओनली, बट इट इज 99%. ऑन 4% इट इज 70% ड्रास्टिकली रिड्यूसिंग. ऑन 10% ओनली 51% मीन्स half recovery is there. And that's why we can say silk is more plastic than elastic. And what are the reasons? Due to its very crystalline polymer system. Higher the crystallinity, lesser will be the elastic properties. Because interpolymer spaces will be very less. So this displacement or deformation will be less. So it is stressed, especially the silk polymers which are already in a stretched state. Beta configuration is a stressed state, will slide past each other. This ruptures a significant number of hydrogen bonds. अगर हम इस पे ज्यादा stretch करेंगे तो hydrogen bonds rupture होंगे. When stretching ceases, the polymers do not return to their original position. और उससे क्या होगा, वापस ये अपनी original position में नहीं आएंगे. Even हम stretching को रोक देंगे तब भी. This disorganizes the polymer system of silk. This disorganizes the polymer system of silk, which is seen as a distortion and wrinkling of the silk textile materials. Now, इसके लिए वो distorted होंगे. So this is elastic plastic properties of silk. The third important property is hygroscopic nature, means moisture absorption qualities as well as static charges development. So hygroscopic property. Or in case of wool, it is very highly absorbent fiber. You can see at standard condition of 65% relative humidity, it is having 14 to 16.3% of moisture regain, which is higher than cotton and viscose even. So it is having very good hygroscopic properties. If you are increasing the relative humidity, it is increasing drastically. At 100% relative humidity, it is 33.3%. And the reasons are due to polarity of peptide groups. The main groups present in this is peptide chains or peptide groups, which are polar in nature. And due to its polarity of peptide groups, the salt linkages and the amorphous nature of its polymer system, they attract water molecules which readily enter the amorphous polymer system of wool. In relatively dry weather, wool may develop static electricity. This is because there are not enough water molecules present in its polymer system to dissipate any static electricity which might develop. Wool textile materials distort more easily in humid conditions. So, however, it is having good moisture properties, but in the highly humid conditions, these are distorted. Here, it is good absorbent, not very, very highly absorbent, but it is good absorbent, more than cotton. No, not than wool. It is incorrect. Please correct it. Remove the wool word here. Good absorbent, and that is more than cotton. And 65% relative humidity, it is 8.9 to 10.1%. And generally, we have to mention the moisture absorption property at standard condition, that is 65% relative humidity. So it is 8.9 to 10.1% only, which is, in case of wool, it is 14 to 16. So please correct the mistake here. It is not wool here. I will correct it and then I will share it. Because silk has a very crystalline polymer system, it is less absorbent than wool. Highly crystalline fibers, it means closer packings. So water molecules cannot easily enter into the polymer system. It means they are less absorbent. The greater crystallinity of silk polymer system allows fewer water molecules to enter than does the more amorphous polymer system of wool. The other hygroscopic properties of silk are similar to these of wool. बाकी जो है static development और other properties जो moisture से related हैं, they are similar as silk. Then thermal properties, I think it will not be visible, so I will read it slowly. It is heat sensitive. It is, in the case of wool, it is heat sensitive. Softening range is very low, 100 degrees centigrade. It handle harshness, and melting point doesn't melt. 130 degrees centigrade it begins to melt. Before 130, it is not melting. After 130, it will get melted and begins to change its color and becomes yellow. Decomposition begins at 180 degrees centigrade. Ignition temperature is 590 degrees centigrade, and it is poor conductor of heat and low heat resistance. And that's why it is having good warmth properties. It is very heat sensitive. Softening rays is similar like wool. Melting point, it doesn't melt. Decomposition begins at 170 degree, and ignition temperature is 420 degrees centigrade. Something about it, reason about thermal properties. Applying excessive amount of heat means too much kinetic energy will result in disulfide bonds rupture and polymer fragmentation. Initially, this polymer fragmentation will only result in surface discoloration of the wool fiber. However, prolonged exposure to heat can result in scorching. The brown-black discoloration of scorched wool is due to the formation of minute particles of carbon, which are black in color. Scorching is usually accompanied by a weakening of the fiber. And due to scorching, the fiber will get weaker. So exposure to higher temperature, and particularly prolonged exposure to higher temperatures, is harmful for wool textile materials. But silk is more sensitive to heat than wool. Thus, is partly due to the lack of any disulfide bonds in the polymer system of silk. And the existing peptide bonds, salt linkages, and hydrogen bonds tends to break down once the temperature exceeds 100 degrees centigrade. 100 से ऊपर होती जो भी इसके salt linkages या hydrogen bonds से वो break होना start होते हैं, और क्योंकि covalent bonds इसमें है नहीं जिनकी strength अच्छी होती है, तो ये ज़्यादा heat sensitive होता है. Last one are the chemical properties, and I will not go into the details of chemical properties because we have less time. We have only 1 minute. So I'm reminding to the students who have to take the screenshots, and all the students, please make attendance by making P in the chat box. And please go through these chemical properties your own, because there is nothing to explain about the chemical properties. What are the effects of acids? What are the effects of alkalis? What are the effects of sunlight and weather? And what is the dye affinity property? And how the bleaches affect the silk and wool? That you can just go through these slides and remember 3-4 important lines about the each effect, like bleaches or dye affinity or sunlight and weather and alkalis and acids. I have given more contents so that you can remember particular important contents only, but you should have the knowledge that how these chemical properties of wool and silk, they are exhibiting these chemical properties.